Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Dr. Philip Phillips, and I'm the Associate Dean of the University Honors College. I'm very pleased to welcome everyone here today, especially our class. It's always good to see all of you and anyone who may be watching today. This lecture series is dedicated to the topic of social justice, and we have a real treat today. Our speaker is Dr. Lewis Woods, Associate Professor of African American History and Presidential Fellow for Social Justice and Equality here at Middle Tennessee State University. He has served as the Africana Studies Program Director, President of the Black Faculty and Staff Association, and he currently serves as Chair of President McPhee's Task Force for Social Justice. Dr. Woods is also the 2018 recipient of the John Pleas Outstanding Faculty Award at MTSU. He graduated Phi Beta Kappa with a BA degree in Africana Studies from SUNY Stony Brook. He earned his MA and PhD in African American History from Howard University. Dr. Woods' research has appeared in such journals as the Journal of Urban History, the Journal of African American History, Health Promotion Practice, the American Journal of Economics and Sociology, and the Journal of North Carolina Association of Historians. I'm grateful for Dr. Woods. I'm grateful to him for collaborating with me on this series and helping me identify some of the speakers who are joining us. So today, Dr. Woods will speak to us about the topic of systemic racism. So please join me in welcoming our speaker.
I appreciate it. Thank y'all for having me. It's a pleasure. If you let me, I'm going to share my screen for you because I have a PowerPoint prepared for today. All right. And so, the title of the topic is race and the policy of exclusion. And so what we're going to do today is talk briefly about some historical barriers to fair housing opportunities, and hopefully get y'all to start thinking a little bit about how this could impact social justice currently in terms of issues related to gaps in wealth, racial gaps in wealth, educational achievement, incarceration rates and encounters with police, and also areas of health as well. And so this is just a generic version of, or not a generic, but a structural issue around structural racism or systemic racism definition. And a lot of times when people talk about systemic issues and systemic racism, what they don't talk enough about, I don't think, is highlighting policies, procedures, and practices. And that's essentially what we're gonna do today. I wanna start out by talking about my grandfather. And I talk about my grandfather for a couple of reasons. One, I know him well, loved him. But two, I think he's representative of a bigger issue that we saw in the post-war period. My grandfather was a naval veteran of World War II, fought in a ship with a predominantly Black crew, one of only two such ships in World War II history. On paper, he had access to the GI Bill, which included a no down payment, down payment mortgage for World War II veterans, right? It took my grandfather 21 years to buy a home, right? He bought the home in 1966, but on paper had access to purchasing it in 1945. He lost a generation of home equity, and the GI Bill from World War II ended in 1955. So he never benefited around housing access from the GI Bill. And his story is representative of most Black World War II veterans. Approximately 3% of African-American veterans, a little bit less actually, were ever able to access the housing component of the GI Bill. And so what this looks at is essentially why a veteran who had access on paper to accessing the mortgage component or the housing component of the GI Bill was never able to access it. And so before we start talking specifically about the GI Bill, I want to just kind of back up a second and talk about some other policies that pertain to accessing and creating and constructing wealth. The Homestead Act of 1862 provided individual homeowners, individual people of European ancestry, access to 160 acres of property west of the Mississippi River if they were if they were individuals, and for families, double that, 320. And I wanted to show you, just want to pause for a second. I want to play you a video of Dr. King speaking specifically about this very issue. So just give me, bear with me for 1 second. And let's hear this this video.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And this is what we are faced with. And
all right. I don't know why the it started showing the ads. I apologize about that. But let's get back to it a little bit. I wanted to, from there, start thinking a little bit about a basic timeline on systemic issues related to housing policy. Before 1910, most people of African ancestry lived in rural areas. The Great Migration saw about 2 million folks after World War I migrate to urban spaces in the North and in the South. 1910, Baltimore becomes one of the very first cities in the nation to create what folks call a racial zone. And essentially what that meant, what that did was it allowed for, it restricted where Black people could live when they migrated to Baltimore. And many cities around the country enacted these, New Orleans, Louisville, others later in the time period. And so from 1910 to 1917, these racial zones, essentially state legislators saying these are the spaces where Blacks can move into in Baltimore, were constitutional. In 1917, in Buchanan versus Worley, the NAACP Legal Defense Fund argued that that was unconstitutional, and the Supreme Court agreed. But what they didn't, what this particular court case started was the practice, really the constitutional practice of racially restrictive covenants. And so, to the right is an example of what a racially restrictive covenant looked like. These were individual deed agreements that individual homeowners filled out and embedded into the property deeds. And this one is from Nashville. It says, neither the premises nor any part thereof shall be sold, aligned, conveyed, or devised to any person of African blood or descent, and that no person of African blood or descent shall own or acquire title therein, either in fee or otherwise, as tenants, lessees. But this covenant does not preclude or prohibit persons of African blood or descent from living on the premises in the capacity of servants. So if you're a chauffeur, if you're a maid, you can live on the premises without violating the covenant. But if you're an equal, not so much. In 1926, the Supreme Court in Corrigan versus Buckley ruled that these covenants were constitutional and did not violate 14th Amendment protections, equal protections under the law. This is an example of a restrictive covenant from just south of San Francisco in San Mateo, California, that neither said lands nor or any portion thereof shall be conveyed or let or leased to any person of African, Mongolian, or Hindu descent, or to person or persons other than those of the Caucasian or white race. So for the first couple decades of the 20th century, you start to see, especially after Corrigan, Buckley, after Buchanan, a slow proliferation of restrictive covenants that gets exacerbated as policies in the 30s happen. The Homeowners Loan Corporation is one example. This particular agency is credited with creating redlining, and they did about 5 million appraisals, which accounted for roughly 20% of urban homes and 1 in 10 housing units in the entire country. They defined Black folks' entry as hazardous. So their appraisal system, the joys of COVID presentations. Okay, green is best. B or blue is still desirable. C, yellow, definitely declining. D, red, hazardous. And so that's where redlining comes from. Here's an example of a security map from Los Angeles, but these maps were everywhere in the country. Any city that had a population over 40,000 people in the 1930s and early 40s has one of these maps. Hundreds of them exist in the National Archives. This particular one in California refers specifically to communities of color. This one has no Blacks, foreign families, people of Mexican ancestry. There's a section that says infiltration, and these guys say the infiltration of goats, rabbits, and dark-skinned babies indicated as a part of their language in the federal housing agency. It's really, Homeowner Loan Corporation, it's really particularly disturbing some of the language. next federal agency, 1934, the following year, Federal Housing Administration. It's very important in terms of increasing homeownership around the country. Prior to the Federal Housing Administration, it required 50% down payment at closing, and that went down to 20% with FHA, and you had from 5 to 7 years to pay back the additional half of the initial down payment prior to FHA and increase it to 30 years. And so FHA federally insured 80% of the home loan value and essentially eliminated bank risk completely, because the homeowner gave 20%, federal government guaranteed 80%, and the bank could collect risk-free mortgage for 30 years, which sounds great and was influential for letting millions of Americans purchase homes. The challenge was the way that they created these policies. This is an underwriting manual from the FHA. If you look here, the second specific aspect talks about protection from adverse influences. I'm gonna tell you a little bit about what those influences were, how they defined them. The evaluator should investigate areas surrounding the location to determine whether or not incompatible racial and social groups are present. If a neighborhood is to retain stability, it is necessary that property shall continue to be occupied by the same social and racial classes. A change in social or racial occupancy generally leads to instability and a reduction of values. And so if you didn't have an adequate protection, you could have your entire, for your property, you could have your entire mortgage loan rejected. It's national in scope. So this is just an example of how big the Federal Housing Administration's scope was in the country. And so from 1944 to 1955, the GI Bill is established, and the FHA and the Veterans Administration collaborate to provide a no down payment mortgage. FHA insures 80%, VA guarantees 20%. This procedure allows millions of Americans to purchase homes, really undergirds the modern American middle class. Between 1962 and by 1962, from 1934 to 1962, these two agencies insured federally mortgage lending up to over $100 billion, less than 2% going to non-whites. And like I said earlier, less than 3% of Black veterans were ever able to access the housing component of the GI Bill. 1950s, you have a shift from federal policies, right? From lending organizations, banks, FHA, VA, Homeowner Loan Corporation, two real estate agents getting involved in this. And so what a blockbusting practice essentially was in the 1950s was Black folks who couldn't get lending in the urban areas are desperate to kind of flee the Black Belt in cities around the country. And what they essentially do, what real estate agents do, is they allow a singular high income person of African ancestry to purchase a home in an all white, previously all white neighborhood. And then they essentially whisper to the people in the white neighborhood and say, look guys, the Negroes are coming, man, you know, and they cause panic selling, right? So what they are able to end up doing is when everybody tries to sell, it depreciates the values and then they can resell it at a profit. And so blockbusting essentially changed neighborhoods that were previously all white to predominantly Black within a year or a few years. And then this elicits white flight to the suburbs. And because of the policies I mentioned earlier, it's rare for African Americans to be able to access federal lending that allows the suburbs to become more affordable. Here's an example of, this is the National Association of Real Estate Boards. And as part of their ethics or a code of ethics that they had, they established some reasons or ways that real estate agents did not want to do. And so this is one of the things that they said, a respectable, as they say real quick, they say basically no real estate agent will do these following things. They say in a respectable neighborhood, a house is wanted, right? The latter might be talking about no reputable broker will provide this or do these things to a predominantly white neighborhood. The latter might be a bootlegger who caused considerable annoyance to his neighbors, a madam who has a number of call girls on her string, a gangster who wanted a screen for his activities by living in a better neighborhood, a colored man of means who was giving his children a college education and thought they were entitled to live among whites. All four of those for the real estate, the largest real estate agency in the country, were synonymous and undesirable in neighborhoods. So by this time, by the 1960s, in places like Chicago and elsewhere, Blacks are so having so much trouble because their communities are deteriorating because they can't get lending to buy new homes or do renovations, right? Over about a 30-year period. What neighborhoods like the West Side of Chicago started to do was people who could access the suburban mortgage insurance and lending by the federal government could leave the areas, rent out their homes in this kind of a quasi-lease contract home buying process. And essentially what they would do is require down payments, but they would not let the deed out of their, the previous owners would lease homes to Black residents, desperate to leave some of these areas, urban centers. They require a down payment, but if you missed a single payment, you could lose not only your deposit, but also be evicted from the neighborhood. And so the missing of a single payment or being late on a single payment could require eviction. And if you were able to make all the payments and all the fees, you would essentially purchase the home for, you know, more than triple what it was worth. And so this was kind of like a mix between a payday loan and the kind of precursors to the adjustable rate mortgages or the interest only mortgages that we saw devastate the American housing market in 2008. 1968, you have this kind of a Fair Housing Act, which eliminates a lot of these discriminatory or egregious practices. The challenge with the 1968 Fair Housing Act is that it has very weak enforcement. And so habitual discriminators were only charged a $1,000 fine. One scholar said it's like giving $2 parking tickets, right? It doesn't make people not want to park in a place that they're not supposed to, right? Similarly, it doesn't stop the habitual discriminators from marginalizing people of African ancestry and people of color. In 1977, you have the Community Reinvestment Act and encourages banks to try to invest in historically divested or marginalized in terms of lending, these kind of lending deserts to invest in those communities. In 1988, the Fair Housing Act is amended and is given more important and impactful enforcement procedures. So habitual discriminators are fined $100,000 per fine. And we see the 21st century, kind of these adjustable rate mortgages, predatory lending. And during the Holder administration, first term of the Obama administration, Eric Holder made several banks pay over $1 billion back because they were in the practice of essentially taking Black and Latin homebuyers who had the same credit scores as their white counterparts and pushing them into these predatory adjustable rate mortgages, which were essentially interest-only payments. And then when the principal kicked in after about 5 years, the mortgage would triple. And so Wells Fargo, Bank of America, lots of these companies are expected to pay back hundreds of millions of dollars in the 21st century. So what are the implications? And this is where I really want our conversation after my presentation to go from here. There's one of the recent racial wealth gap studies that found that by 2053, median Black family wealth will be zero. That's the name of the wealth study. Home ownership gap. Zillow did a study recently that found that the gap between white and Black home ownership rates is worse today than it was in 1900. As of 2019, Black home ownership rates were actually worse than they were in 1968 when the Fair Housing Act was passed. And it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, right? It's a self-fulfilling generational inequity. Today, 74% of neighborhoods that were labeled as hazardous or red in the 1930s and 40s are still low income, still considered hazardous today, right? Still lower income areas. And the yellow areas, the declining areas, have a similar constitution today. And I want to just talk briefly about this kind of analogy that I have around systemic issues, structural issues that I like to use because it helps me kind of crystallize, and I hope it'll help for you crystallize what happens when you're on the wrong side of these policies and procedures, these systemic structural issues. If I am on the right side of a federal policy, it's like swimming downstream, right? I can swim, but even if I take a rest, the current of the river will propel me forward, right? For people who are on the other side of these policies, it's like swimming upstream, up a mighty river with the current that pushes you back. And so as you swim, you're not making as much progress. In fact, it requires energy just to stay stagnant. And so if you can swim fast enough, go against the current, you can jump out of the water, kind of like salmon do, right? Get to the next plane and of the river and keep swimming up, making progress at each socioeconomic step that you get. Now, the challenge is when salmon jump out of the water, what's waiting for them? Mighty bear jaws, right? So somebody has to swim against the current, jump out of the water, dodge the bear claw, the bear teeth and claws, hit the ground and keep on swimming, right? And so the reality is that these systems, they may not be, the current may not be visible to the fish, but it certainly influences the fish's ability to progress, whether they're going with the current or against it. And in fact, when salmon get to the reach there, the top of the riverbed where they spawn, they often die of exhaustion. And so for me, that is a kind of a metaphor for some of the struggles that people who are on the other side of these structural, institutional, systemic issues experience. These are some of the books that I used in kind of preparing the presentation: Color of Law, Family Properties, The Color of Money, Race for Profit, in case you all are interested in for your edification. These are also some sources: redlining links, federal banking, appraisal policies, right? Access to the digital version of the underwriting manuals, et cetera. Community Reinvestment Act, right? And some of these other issues that we were talking a little bit about. All right. I guess I could ask y'all individual questions, but my thought is maybe we could pause this and get y'all to think about, let's open up a conversation. What do y'all think?
I had a quick question.
Please.
Actually two. One of them doesn't relate to this at all. And the other one does. So first question, why is it called Africana Studies?
Okay. Well, that's a good question. In the 60s, it was called Black Studies. And then it was African American Studies. But some people felt like the experience of people of that, then there's also diasporic studies, like African diaspora studies. But part of the struggle was that when people hear diaspora, sometimes think of like Jewish diasporas and other diasporas. And so people say Africana to encompass essentially the broader of African ancestry experience, right? Because some people of African ancestry don't associate themselves as being Black. They're more in focusing on ethnic groups, ethno-linguistic groups, Yoruba, Igbo, Hausa, Fulani, right? But identify as African. So it's kind of been an evolving...
an evolving topic thing.
Correct. Okay. But it means the same, but I think people have been trying to tweak the language to make it more appropriate for more groups of people of African ancestry.
Okay, thank you. And then my second question is, when you were talking about all the different housing things that were like in the 60s,
yep.
Were there like discrepancies between northern and southern states as to like how many people were able to get into houses, or was it just pretty like even discrimination across the board of all the states?
That's a great question. So, you know, when we talk about civil rights legacies, right? And we look at the role of the federal government and civil rights is on the right side of history, right? The federal government, comes in, state laws are imposed that are discriminatory, federal law supersedes state law, the federal government comes in and essentially enforces federal law that's mandating equality, right? In housing, the federal government is on the wrong side of history. They are essentially promoting discrimination in housing. They're promoting segregation. And so the process is national in scope. I mean, James Baldwin once said that, you know, policies like urban renewal or Negro removal, and urban renewal is kind of a precursor to gentrification. he also famously said that when Black people migrate to cities, they don't integrate cities, they move into Black spaces of cities. And so when you think about it, I'm from Long Island, New York originally, and you know, Harlem, parts of the Bronx, where my mom was born, the South Bronx, where my mom was born, which is also the birthplace of hip hop. It's not me, I'm not bragging on it, but I'm just saying it's true, right? It's my mama's spot. but why I bring it up is that Harlem is as segregated as any, was as segregated as any other space in the country. Compton, Watts in on the West Coast, same thing. Oakland back in the day, same thing. South side of Chicago, parts of Detroit. This is a national phenomenon because the federal government was pushing it. So it's a really great question. In housing policy, the federal government is not the champion that it is in civil rights narratives.
Okay, thank you. That really answered my question.
Awesome. Thank you for asking it. Other thoughts?
I would just like to mention, like, I work for an attorney, a real estate attorney, and I do title insurance. So one of the things that is on our title insurance is that they will provide a title insurance provides attorney's fees for, if you have to go to court regarding your property, things of that nature. Mm-hmm. So one of the things on there is that they will, an attorney will represent you and they will pay for it if there are any, racially motivated restrictions. Yeah. Like for every subdivision and such, there are restrictions, and I'm sure people who own homes know that. But they will, provide you an attorney to take care of those things in court.
Sure.
If anyone tries to, you know, uphold those restrictions.
Right. No, your point is well taken. And, you know, look, the racially restrictive covenants I referenced earlier were deemed unconstitutional, the enforcement of them in Shelley versus Kramer, 1948. But why this is significant is, you know, when people talk about, say, for example, the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., they often talk a lot about, you know, the March on Washington and I Have a Dream speech. But by 1966, Dr. King goes to he goes to Chicago, and one of the attempts he does is to mitigate segregation in the South Side, in housing specifically. And these guys, they protest. And they protest in parts of Chicago like Cicero, which had been really discriminatory towards people of African ancestry. Lots of folks, tens of thousands of Blacks worked in Cicero, but none lived there. And the issues that folks experienced there, from real estate agents, from neighbors and community members, they said was even maybe more scary, more people than some of the violence that they had witnessed in the South. And so why I think this is significant is that one of the things that they did, to talk about your comment about real estate agencies, what they did was to highlight the discrimination that Black folks faced, they essentially created two identical potential prospective home buyers, done from staffers from SCLC who were both white and Black. And when the Black folks went to the real estate agents, the agencies were like, oh, we don't have anything outside of the South Side or the West Side or some of these other specific areas that were at that point predominantly of African ancestry. And then when the white staffer from the SCLC, or the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, Dr. King's organization, when he came in, they essentially were like, oh, for the white staffers, we got everything. We got suburban communities, we got, right? And so what they highlighted was essentially that there was two different real estate markets in the country, right? One for whites and one for non-whites. And many institutions, from real estate to banking, to federal agencies, even to, you know, benefits from our military personnel, all were influenced by this kind of deep-rooted structural bias. Oh, and let me say this real quickly too, and this is important. as a country, our home ownership rate doubles between 1930 and 1960. We go from 30% in 1930 to 62% in 1960. And it has a lot to do, more to do with this federal influx of billions of dollars to prospective home buyers to make it easier and more less expensive to, hold on, so I'm sorry. My middle schooler is giving me the business. So sorry about that. So this is real life in COVID. So essentially, what we essentially saw was that this has been a struggle for people a lot, and it was structural and it was systematic. And I just wanted to get y'all to think about: do you think there are some broader implications for today? Housing.
I have one question.
Please.
Sorry. No, please. What you just mentioned, from 32% to 60%, what year was that? Like, did you measure that from?
From 1930 to 1960. So it goes, okay. The nation, we're 30% of Americans are homebuyers. And it makes sense that 30% could afford a home in 1930, because before the Federal Housing Administration comes to be, you had to put down 50% down at closing. So imagine if today, let's say the average home is $200,000 for starters, right? Under those conditions, you'd have to put down $100,000 upfront, down payment, before you could walk in the house. And then you had 5 to 7 years to pay for the additional $100,000 to pay off the other half of the house. I mean, how many people got $100,000 sitting around in the Show of hands. If you do, I want to borrow $1.50, right? I mean, like, legit, none of us, very few of us have that kind of cash around. And so very few Americans could afford to buy a house. It was only those who were wealthy enough to put a huge lump sum down and then pay off another huge lump sum in 5 to 7 years. What the FHA does is it allows you to put down 20%, and then now it's like 3%, even less, but initially allows you to put down 20%, and then you have a generation or more to pay it back. And so it essentially makes homeownership, once you put the down payment down, if you're an individual who doesn't have military service, no down payment required if you're a GI, you know, a veteran, but then you have a generation or more to pay it off, and it makes homeownership actually cheaper than renting. So not only is the monthly bill cheaper than renting, but you are generating generational wealth in the process. And that equity, which is the gap between what the house is worth and what you still owe on it, you can borrow against that from banks, get a home equity line of credit, use it to pay for your kids' college education. You can use it to help your child with the down payment on a home. You can do all kinds of stuff with the home equity line of credit. And so you can then essentially borrow from the bank account that you live in. And it
Now they're even offering loans where you don't have to put anything down, no money down and no closing costs.
Right.
So, I mean, it's a lot different than what it used to be.
I agree. But as a country, we are roughly around 41% of people of African ancestry are homeowners today, as opposed to roughly 74% of white Americans. So the gap is tremendous. And that impacts wealth, that impacts a whole host of stuff. Property taxes fund public schools. So you can see how inequities in property influence the revenue that goes into public school resourcing, et cetera, right? So there are a lot of implications, man. I think it's an important topic to underscore some of the broader struggles. Other questions or thoughts, comments?
I had something to add. Basically, when you said that Black people or not people of non-white skin color, they don't integrate when they move into cities, they move into their own communities that have already been there. I didn't really realize that was a thing outside of my town, basically because like I come from like a very racist town. We had like a rebel flag parade and everything. And basically I never realized that I could map out where each, like I can map out where the poor whites live in my head. I know where they live. I know where the poor Blacks live. I know where the rich white people live. I know where the Hispanics live. Like I didn't know that this was like a right widespread issue. I thought it was just my community because of, you know, it's philosophies.
Right. I mean, no, bro. Yeah, what you're saying about your community is largely something that if you know the neighborhood or the demographics of a community in a lot of parts of the country, you can say similar things. I mean, in parts of Long Island, I could be like, that's where folks who are Catholic, that's who folks who are Jewish, that's who folks who are right Black, that's who folks who don't have as much money, that's people who got all the money. I mean, it's so it's not a you know, where we live was not an act of God, y'all. I mean, it was an act of intentional policy. It was not just kind of, didn't just appear out of the ether. This was a series of policies that led to, you know, where people can access. And the implications are stark. You know, if y'all are familiar with, you know, with Brentwood, we now live in East Nashville, but for years we lived in Antioch, but our neighbors would call it Brentioch, which is kind of on that Antioch-Brentwood border. So Concord Road was maybe a mile and a half from my old house. And the first time I drove down Concord Road in Brentwood, man, I told my wife, I was like, the windows were down. I said, you smell that? She said, what? I said, money. I mean, because you drive down there and there are homes that are gated. They're, you know, 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 square foot homes. They're on golf courses. And all of those property taxes go to funnel into Brentwood Public Schools. And so when you start talking about the funding formula for how our public schools get money, it replicates inequity, right? Because you know, some communities have $1 million homes, some communities have Section 8 homes, right? And all in between. And some people have a lot of housing and a lot of property ownership, some have very little. So it sets the playing field up to kind of replicate some of that generational inequity. Other thoughts?
So John? Let's say, like, going forward wise, mm-hmm. So we've gained long way compared to like 41%, but we still have a long way to go to 73% just to kind of make it balance out.
Sure.
But how do you see that kind of reaching that time point? Because, like, in a sense, how many years approximately, like, what actions could we possibly take to kind of equalize it in a sense?
That's a great question. It's a $1 trillion question, honestly, because one of the struggles that we have is that, folks who have resources or have family members who have resources are in much better. It's almost like if you use a baseball analogy, some of us are born on third base. Yeah. They are 60 feet away from or 90 feet away from a scoring run. Yeah. Other people are born in the dugout. Heck, maybe not even in the stadium. Right. I mean, so even just getting onto the playing field requires a huge amount of effort and energy. And so for those of us who are born on base, if we advance from, you know, first to third or from third to home, and we don't acknowledge where we started and the privilege we had in our starting position, then I think that we celebrate ourselves a bit too much. Yeah. Similarly, if you're born in the dugout, heck, if you get on the playing field, that is an accomplishment, right? I mean, that's something to be proud of. You're not born in the stadium and you get to the dugout, woo, good job, right? And I think you should celebrate yourself perhaps more than we often do people who make minor influences over a generation or two. I would say a couple of things. One is there definitely could probably need to be something structural done around accessing housing, because for middle-class Americans, the equity in your home is the biggest component of your wealth, period, right? So people who don't own homes have profoundly less wealth than people who own homes. That's for starters. Second, and because property is a finite commodity, they're not making new property, the value tends to go up and up and up. I'll give you an example. So my grandfather, World War II vet, moved the family to the South Bronx, well, actually for Harlem first, then the South Bronx. By 1966, he moves the family out to Long Island, loses a generation of home equity. But there's a famous post-war, largely veteran community in Long Island called Levittown. Levittown, famous post-war community in New York. They also had one in New Jersey and in Pennsylvania. These were 20, 30,000 people communities, huge. The homes in Levittown in 1947, 48 were purchased for $5,000, $6,000. Those homes in Levittown today go for $750 to $1 million. And so a $6,000 investment, that's no down payment, in 1947, 48 can yield upwards of $1 million today. That changes trajectories, right? And the problem, if there's no structural way, it's very difficult to catch up when you haven't had access to that wealth construction from the post-war period. And so one thing that I think can do, one solution that I think can happen from this is to encourage people to start saving early and often on an individual level, but to understand that without something structural, it'll be very difficult for them in their lifetimes to completely even the playing field. But y'all are in your, you know, younger teens, 20s. If you start saving for retirement today, over a 40-year period, there's no reason why, you know, even a couple, 10% of what you make, 15% of what you make over a lifetime, you can create some equity, some balance in that. But still, it requires information to even get in the game, to get skin in that game. I started investing when I was 25. So almost over a generation ago. And I did it because I have an uncle who's a dentist who told me to do it. You know what I mean? And so I was blessed to do that. And so I'm in a good position financially, but I wouldn't have started doing what I did if it wasn't for a family member. So I bring it up because if you don't have family members who happen to have it, happen to be dentists, who happen to own their own dental practices, who are looking for ways to limit their tax liability and are started investing in all of this, you know, extra resources to make capital gains and other kinds of taxes to minimize the other expenses, you're probably not going to start early. Does that make sense? And when you don't own money, when you don't own homes, or you don't have wealth construction in your families, there's going to have to be something massive to change that, I think. And so I think part of the challenge that we're facing to mitigate some of that is creating maybe some of the will to even recognize that there's a problem to then be able to potentially address it. And I think as a country, I don't know if you can get everybody to agree that there even is a problem, right? I mean, concepts like white privilege are controversial, for instance, or systemic racism, controversial, for example, right? So yeah, it's a great question, though. It's a $1 trillion question.
I think you're kind of sharing an example.
Oh, sorry. Oh, I know multiple people talking at the same time. Say again.
Okay, I just want to share a quick example.
Yeah.
Back in my home country, what they kind of did right now, they have very low home ownership percentage for females. Mm-hmm. So kind of what they have started doing recently in like the past couple of years is like they've kind of started to subsidize like that and require less down payment for if like those have females are buying, purchasing homes like that.
Yep.
Like apartments compare that, there's like a higher percentage for like male individuals that are buying it. Mm-hmm. So if we do that like systematically wise and just promote the Black home ownerships and that, how like would that be a good starting point in a sense?
Oh, I think it would be a game changer. Yeah, I think it would be a game changer, dude. But I think the struggle for a lot of folks is that, you know, in order to get the political will, first of all, I don't think you can get half of Congress to agree that the sky is blue. Let alone some of these bigger, broader structural systemic issues, right? But in order to create the political will, you would have to have a critical mass of the country acknowledge that this is a problem. And I think that as a country, one of the things, you know, y'all know when you talk about K-12, when you talk about America, you talk about hard work equaling upward mobility, right? And that people get where they are because of how hard they worked, right? And we don't often talk about systems and challenge that narrative. I, you know, I argue, you know, who worked harder than the enslaved, right? And there was no wealth to be constructed as a result of that, right? So hard work for everybody hasn't equaled the same level of upward mobility for other individuals. And so to not acknowledge that as a systemic problem, I think, would make it hard to pass a legislation that focused specifically on targeting communities that were left out, right? Purposefully, intentionally by the federal government. I think it would require a massive educational, some work to re-educate or at least to acknowledge some of these systems. And these systems are invisible, like the water is to the fish for a lot of people. You know you're a homeowner, but many people don't know how your family started getting it. My granddad came home from the war. He worked hard. Okay, well, that's true. But he was also on the right side of a federal program that helped to generate wealth for middle-class Americans. Does that make sense? And so to acknowledge that, I think, is the most important piece, because if not, you will congratulate yourself for being born on third base. There was a question. I think it was Zach. I saw your...
Yeah, I was going to say, you're bringing up a really important point with the home equity loans and getting into investing when you're young, because right now is like the most important time. Like right now, I'm saving up money right now because I want to buy a house. I don't want to live in that house. I want to rent that house to somebody, and I want to start raking in income. You know, by the time I'm 30, I want at least 10 rental properties.
Sure.
I don't want to have to work after 35, you know? So I think bringing in that and getting a home young and then not living in it. Like, I mean, I'm planning on doing this like next year, going to buy a house, going to get ready. And just, you know, not have to work anymore. I think too many people my age forget about that. And they're like, yeah, I'm gonna be a wage slave and I'm gonna live the rest of my life, get a 401k. I think a 401k is the dumbest thing ever. I mean, why would I waste my money on that? I think totally being self-sufficient, not relying on a 401k,
yeah,
going full on with home housing or investment properties, and living your life like that. I think that's much smarter than stability of a 401k.
Hey man, I think your point is well taken. Look, there are principally three ways to create wealth, right? Own property, own a business, invest in other people's business, right? So what you're essentially talking about is owning property, making that property ownership part of your business strategy. And I'll tell you, man, capitalism rewards ownership. So homeowners get more back in taxes than renters. Business owners get more back in taxes than people who get a paycheck, right?
Exactly. So you're getting into that lower tax bracket, which is the important part of this. I mean, you look at small businesses, you're paying up on the very high end of the tax bracket. Right. That's why it's not beneficial to have a small business. I personally don't believe that, at least.
Well, I hear you. I mean, compared to Amazon, absolutely. The small business guy is getting smacked upside the head compared to these major giants. There's no question about that. And I have a friend, frankly, who he left corporate America and started a rental property business in the area. It has, you know, upwards of about 20 different duplexes. And he makes a lot of money because the federal government, the tax code essentially rewards ownership. So as a homeowner, if my HVAC unit goes out, I got to eat that $8,000, right? Just take it on the chin. But if I'm renting this property and the HVAC goes under, I can write that off as depreciation on my taxes. And so my friend 2 years ago, he's got about between $3 and $4 million in rental property ownership throughout Middle Tennessee. This dude made back in taxes over $120,000.
And that's the thing is when you're getting you're making $100,000 and paying 40% in taxes versus making $100,000 and paying 10 to 15% in taxes. That's a lot more money.
I hate to stop our conversation, but we are out of time.
Okay.
I want to thank Dr. Woods for his presentation and for sharing with us some aspects of our culture and our economy that are often invisible. And Dr. Woods, you've given us a lot to think about, particularly these structural issues. And thank you, everybody, for being here today. And I look forward to seeing everyone next week.
All right. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I have a question. Will we be able to get the slides that Dr. Woods presented?